yes, yes.
Now, the big story of the day was, of course, David Cameron's speech today. Last week, he criticised Oxford University for letting too few black students in. This week, he's moved on to criticise the rest of the country for letting too many immigrants in. Now, I mean, it seems to me that there wasn't any new policy in the speech, so it kind of sounds like he's just repositioning himself away from the Lib Dems, like separating, the Tories are separating themselves from their coalition partners ahead of the local elections on the 5th of May. Am I wrong, maybe? Is it a genuine issue, do you think?
He's trying to say, look, I'm not a racist, but if you are, you can still vote for me.
I don't know. It does seem that he's going to the right. He's clearly putting some sort of clear blue water between himself and the Lib Dems.
Yeah.
And he's saying this, but it seems that he's kind of, you know, it seems a bit kind of sort of send them back. And I don't like that at all. I don't like it when politicians even bring it up. And where do you draw the line? Because my family came over in the 70s. I think 1066 has got to be our line in the sand. I think anyone that's arrived since 1066 has to fuck off.
Take it back to the Ostrogoths? What are we going to do?
The Ostrogoths? They sound like a great band.
It's one of those sort of dog whistle speeches, basically, where he didn't say anything that controversial. He sort of said he was in favour of good immigration, which no one can really disagree with.
Right.
But people who've got, you know, are listening out for a certain thing hear a voice of agreement with their views. It's
kind
of like
racists who want to vote for someone who might get in.
Yes.
Isn't it? That's...
Oh, what about Vince Cable's reaction? Because, you know, he said it was I think, maybe going to be inflammatory.
Maybe there's a bit of that. I mean, the Lib Dems, maybe no one will ever vote for them again, of the way they're going. So I think maybe Cameron's saying, I tell you what, I'll say this slightly right-wing thing, and then you can say a slightly left-wing thing, but, you know, doesn't actually change our policy, and you might get a chance in the local elections as a result.
Perhaps Cable could just stand at the side and vomit every time. That would be amazing.
I think he should start dancing again. I miss it. I miss him dancing.
It seems like an odd thing for Cameron to bring up, the whole kind of thing with immigration, because ultimately it'll lead to, you know, why are we in Europe, and that's the thing that always tears the Tories apart. Someone will mention that. Someone will go, well, we're in Europe, people can just arrive from Europe and work here. That's fine, isn't it? Mm. And they go, well, no, it isn't. But to put that to a vote, good luck.
How would Vince have learned to flamenco dance unless we could get the teachers over here? That's my question.
Yes, if he relied on British dances, then to all
the Morris,
yeah,
the Maypole,
honestly,
the Gaygons.
Have you ever danced round a Maypole? You haven't lived.
I haven't. You're right. I haven't done that particular weird fertility dance.
All right. Well, with that, we'll see you after the break.
Welcome back. Now, my guest tonight is one of the people lucky enough to have benefited from the News International complimentary answer phone checking service. A brilliant system whereby details of your calendar and personal life automatically sync with the front page of the News of the World. She also once said she would jump under a bus for Tony Blair. Understandably, she's never been able to quite recapture that first thrill of suicidal adoration with his successors. But I gather she would have let Gordon Brown drive a car over her foot, and Ed Miliband is allowed to slightly bump her with a tricycle. Please welcome the Shadow Cabinet Office Minister, Tessa Jowell. In terms of, about the phone hacking, do you think, as Boris Johnson has suggested, that there should be a Truth and Reconciliation Commission into the phone hacking scandal and the conduct of the press in general?
Well, I think there's got to be a lot more truth about what actually happened. And there is a police inquiry, third police inquiry, that
third
is now
lucky.
Underway.
Mm? Third time lucky.
Third time lucky. Yeah. Let's hope it's third time lucky, thorough. And I think the important thing is that everybody cooperates with the police inquiry and gets to the bottom of who knew what and what actually happened.
And why didn't Labour hold a public inquiry into press methods when they were in power? Do you think... Are all politicians scared of News International?
No, I mean, I don't... You know, politicians are not scared of News International, but I think the specific proposal, David, you're referring to, was a proposal by Gordon Brown quite late and before, just before the last election, when there was the stuff about hacking was beginning to emerge.
Yeah.
And I think the cabinet secretary, maybe with a degree of wisdom, thought it was unwise and might have seen it as being politically motivated to have an inquiry about phone hacking. I think, as he put it, at a time when The Sun and other papers owned by News International had made it absolutely clear they weren't going to support Labour.
Had there been a phone hacking scandal about a paper that supported the Labour Party, it would have been easier to...
No. I mean, the important thing is that this is criminal activity and it's therefore a matter for the police to investigate.
And as a former culture secretary, do you think that the relationship between the police and the press has become blurred?
I think there are there's some evidence to suggest it may have done, and I think that this specific inquiry into News International needs to look first of all at what went on at News International, why two police inquiries made so little progress and uncovered so little, and then I think the third element is to understand what, if any, the relationship was between News International and the press. And I think there are questions to answer in each of those three areas. And I think that we can be confident that the police are properly engaged in this time.
So this time they mean it. But what do you think? Do you think this should affect the B Sky B takeover decision at all?
I don't actually think that this investigation into criminal activity should affect what is essentially a competition decision with safeguards in relation to B Sky B. I think the important thing about the B Sky B takeover is that we continue to have the same kind of range of opinions expressed, plurality, and that it doesn't prevent other investment in innovation in our media market in exactly the same way that, what is it now, nearly 12, 13 years ago, Sky invested, and because Sky invested, we got digital television at the rate and scope that we did. So I think the two decisions need to be seen as separately, but I think there are very important public interest questions about a takeover of B Sky B that should be answered.
Media plurality there.
That'll do.
Yeah, now, yes, that's close enough. Now, there's so much more to this phone hacking scandal that we can't sort of talk about now for various, for legal reasons, but I hope you'll come back on at some point in the future when all the dirt can finally be dished. But for now, we'll have to move on from that. And I'd like to ask you about the British politics in general. Do you feel fewer people vote now than did 20 years ago? And people say that about the Tories, there are a lot of millionaires in the cabinet. In the Labour Party, the top two people in the election for the new leader were both members of the same family. I think it looks to people that politicians are an increasingly insular group and perhaps less accountable and perhaps fewer people who've had proper jobs beforehand. Do you see that as a problem?
I think it's a risk, and I think in different ways it's a risk for the two major parties. And incidentally, the first point you made about this sort of breaking away from the dominance of the two major parties is one of the reasons that I'm supporting a small change to the voting system with the alternative vote. But I think that the risk is that you have increasingly Labour members of Parliament, elected Labour representatives who are much younger and have only ever been involved in politics.
People they were an MP's assistant, they worked at a think tank,
absolutely.
Then they became an MP.
And I think that if the Parliamentary Labour Party became dominated by people who didn't have outside experience, it would be impoverished by that. Mm. In exactly the same way that I think that if the Tory Parliamentary Party becomes dominated by people in their late 50s who've had very successful careers in business and are rather removed from the kind of raw experience of most of the people that they represent, then I think that too would be a pity. I think that diversity is just so important.
But how do we stop politics becoming, as it were, just a a profession in itself, an isolated profession of people who seek to govern and who haven't actually lived in the society that they want to be in charge of?
Well, most people have lived in the society that they want to make a contribution to, and very few politicians simply want to govern. People go into politics overwhelmingly for very good reasons, because they're committed to their local area, because they want to serve their local community. And I think, you know, we're a statement of the obvious, we're in opposition. And opposition is quite different from being in government. You can campaign against the government, but you're not in the position of being able to take decisions day by day. And I think that this is an opportunity for Labour members of Parliament to broaden their experience, to learn new skills, do the kinds of things that will enrich a parliamentary party ready to be returned to government at the next election.
Ed Miliband is certainly enriching us, because he says he spent the best 3 hours he'd had in a long time playing pool in Doncaster. So he's enriching his life. What does that say about the rest of his life?
Well, I think the rest of his life is very busy. Yeah. The rest of his life is enriched probably much more by his two little boys and by his partner than 3 hours playing pool.
OK, well, pool can be brilliant, though, and children, children can be annoying.
This is not an anti-pool moment.
Thank you very much,
Tessa Jowell. Thank you very much.